Heavy flooding hit parts of Ontario again this spring. It's become a common occurrence and raises major issues about how to cope and how to plan for the future. Elizabeth English is an associate professor of architecture at the University of Waterloo. For her, it's all about learning to live with water. She is also the founder and director of the Buoyant Foundation Project, which designs and builds houses that float rather than flood. And she joins us now for more. Welcome. It's very nice to have you to the program for the very first time.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here. What is the Buoyant Foundation Project?
The Buoyant Foundation Project is what I call my umbrella research group. So it's an organization name under which I conduct the research for developing amphibious construction, designs for amphibious housing, but mostly retrofit.
Well, I mean, that leads us into the next question. What is amphibious construction?
Well, so amphibious construction refers to designing a building so that it looks like an ordinary building most of the time, but when a flood comes, and only when a flood comes, it will float up, straight up, directly up, and then as the flood goes away, come back down and rest on its original foundation again. So it needs buoyancy to make it float, and it needs a vertical guidance system so that it doesn't float away.
I mean, for you, I know this is what you do all the time. So when you say it, it sounds like, oh yeah, yeah, this is what's happening. For me, that is outstanding. Like, that is such a fascinating concept. How did you start doing this work?
I started doing this right after Hurricane Katrina. So I've been working on this for 13 years. Mm-hmm. But I was one of three full-time faculty members at the Louisiana State University Hurricane Center. And I went there because I'd had 25 years of experience at that point of working on wind effects on buildings, mm-hmm. doing wind tunnel studies and analyzing wind effects on buildings. So at the Hurricane Center, I was there to deal with wind. But Hurricane Katrina happened, mm-hmm. and I very quickly realized that this was a flood event, not a wind event, and that the flood events, the consequences of the flood events were even more catastrophic. And I experienced quite a bit of the trauma that people were going through, and it absolutely horrified me. And I said, this doesn't have to happen. Maybe I can do something to help people not have to suffer like this in the future.
So how did you come up with this idea of necessarily not like putting a house on stilts, but making it buoyant, as you said?
Well, the Federal Emergency Management Agency in the US, which is the group that comes in after a flood and tries to help people.
FEMA?
FEMA, yes. So FEMA was telling everybody that they had to put their houses up on stilts or on higher foundations. But there's a way of living in New Orleans that's very closely tied to being very near the sidewalk, very slightly off the ground, sitting on your front porch and talking to your neighbors as they walk by. And the houses are all close by together. And it's the housing typology is such that if you start putting some of the houses way up on stilts, it's going to be completely disruptive, not just visually to the look of the neighborhood, but also to the way of life.
I guess because people wouldn't be able to go door to door, sit on the porch.
They can't sit on the front porch and have their neighbor walk by not farther away than mm-hmm. you are from me mm-hmm. and have a chat along the way. So the neighborhoods that developed were very closely tied together, and to start fragmenting them in that way, mm-hmm. And also forcing people to change their lifestyle. And the architect in me objected to that.
Well, how did you learn about amphibious construction, that this could be the option?
Well, I didn't know about it, but I started thinking about what could be done so that people could continue to live at the level that they're accustomed to living, just a meter or so above the ground, but still be safe when the flood comes. And floating up with the flood seemed like maybe an idea.
And this has been done elsewhere,
right? Well, then I discovered that they were doing that in the Netherlands, mm-hmm. and so I learned about that. And then I held a course at LSU dealing with this, and one of the students in the class was from a family that had a summer place on a lake where people had been doing this for almost 30 years at that point.
Was that something that just kind of made you frustrated that, you know, it's not something
no,
that people know more about?
Well, I was frustrated that people didn't know more about it, but I wanted to help people know more about it. I was thrilled to find this working example where they'd already tested out a lot of the ideas that I was trying to develop. And so they became my good friends and my teachers.
And so I guess the way that this would work is this would be done to homes that already exist.
That's why I do. Well, I do existing homes for two reasons. The first reason is that what I wanted to do was help people who were already in communities and didn't want to have their communities fragmented, didn't want to have the look and feel and way of life in the community dramatically changed by putting them way up in the air, and also didn't want to be forced to move away, didn't want to have no other options but either put their house up
Or move.
Mm-hmm. Or live in danger. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to work with existing communities and people who already had houses, and this would be a way to make their houses safer, protect the house and their belongings. Mm-hmm. It's not for staying in the house during the flood. So the people evacuate, but the wonderful thing is that when they come back, they're not heartsick over the damage and loss and everything that's destroyed and the process of going to live somewhere else while their house is being cleaned out and everything's thrown out. It's a terrible, terribly traumatic situation that people find themselves in. Well, if they go away and there's a terrible flood, but the house goes up, sits on top of the flood, the water does what it wants because the house isn't in the way of the water.
Right.
And when the water goes away, the house comes back down, looks just like it did beforehand, and the people come back and there's no damage.
Well, we're talking about this idea of retrofitting homes. We should show people maybe how it works. We have a video here. Can you explain to us what's happening in the video, please?
Okay, well, first, the house and the floor framing are flying off very fast. And then the perimeter wall goes up a little bit, and then the vertical guidance posts drop in, and then the pre-manufactured dock floats that provide the buoyancy, and then the framing that takes the uplift from the buoyancy, and then the rest of the house comes back down, and now the flood comes, and the telescopic poles it's a pole inside a pole attached to the inner sleeve at the top of it. And so when the house goes up, it pulls the inner post up from the sleeve, like an old-fashioned car antenna.
Right. It's
or
like
the handle on your rollerboard suitcase. So it pulls up, uh-huh. and then it goes back down.
So when it senses the water, it goes up?
It's attached to the floor framing. Mm-hmm. So you saw that there was some structure going in to take the uplift from the buoyancy blocks. Mm-hmm. And so that has little tabs that stick out from underneath the perimeter of the house, and those tabs attach to the top of the inside pole.
Okay.
So when the flood comes and the buoyancy lifts the house.
Oh, the water lifts
the water lifts the house. The whole thing happens entirely passively. There's no mechanical systems. There's no buttons you have to push. You can be far away on vacation when the flood comes, and your house will do this by itself without your being there. You have to make accommodation for the utilities, but mm-hmm. that's a standard process and it's not difficult.
Does this work with houses that have basements or?
It's not so good for basements at this stage. Mm-hmm. This is very early development of the technology, so we're dealing with the easiest things first.
It looks expensive.
It's not expensive. It's actually really inexpensive because compared to putting a house up on stilts or elevating, because when you elevate a house, put it on stilts, you have to put in a whole new foundation system. Mm-hmm. But if you're doing a retrofit and the cost of the retrofit is less than 50% of the value of the house, then the new construction can be what we call grandfathered in, which means that you don't have to bring everything in the house up to the latest standards. You can use what's there. So you can use the existing gravity load-bearing foundation system for the house, and you don't have to pull that out and put that back into the earth again the way you do if you put a house up on stilts.
So you would go into a crawl space then, or?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's
why when I said now the perimeter walls or the foundation wall is being raised a little bit, that's because the crawl space on that house wasn't deep enough for the buoyancy blocks.
Okay.
So you have to jack the house up a little bit. It doesn't have to fly away. Yeah. Jack it up a little bit so that there's enough room to get underneath there. And then if there isn't enough space to fit in the framing and the buoyancy blocks and have a little bit of space left between the blocks and the ground, because you don't want the blocks sitting on the ground, then you have to heighten the perimeter wall a little bit, but doesn't have to be too much.
This is so interesting. It's such a cool idea. When you first saw this in real life, what was your reaction?
Well, when I first saw it, it was the vacation homes mm-hmm. in Old River Landing, Louisiana. On a lake where people went to go fishing. And I saw it there and it was amazing, but I had already had this a very, very similar idea in my mind. And so this just confirmed that the idea that I had could actually work. And in fact, these people had been showing how it works for 30 years. Mm-hmm. Now, they'd been, you know, doing it without a lot of calculations from professionals and without a lot of applications for building code, building permits, and without a lot of attention to the building codes, because they're actually in a place that is outside the Mississippi River levee system. It's on a lake that a long, skinny, curved lake that used to be part of the course of the Mississippi River. But the Mississippi River, before it was concreted in, used to change its course quite a lot.
So there were houses there?
There were no houses there. It was a piece of the river, and the river jumped to the other side of an island.
Why did you decide to expand this beyond Louisiana?
Partly because FEMA wouldn't allow me to do it. So
why is that?
Because FEMA, for a very good reason, in general, in that FEMA doesn't want the technology to be developed to the point that developers can come in and create new neighborhoods in floodplains and have them be safe places for people to live. So in order to prevent new amphibious construction in inappropriate places, mm-hmm. and I absolutely agree with that. We shouldn't be putting in new communities in floodplains. But because they didn't want to see that happen, they were just making a blanket statement that you couldn't do amphibious construction at all.
Does this impact insurance by any way?
Yes, it does. Yeah. And in the US, there is the National Flood Insurance Program, the NFIP, which is administered by FEMA. Mm. So this is the stick that FEMA has. So they told me if I persuaded any municipality to give me a building permit, that would seriously jeopardize that entire community's good standing with the NFIP.
Well, what about the work that you're doing in Canada?
So, I've been in Canada for 12 years, and I arrived here shortly after Hurricane Katrina, and after being at the LSU Hurricane Center. And it was pointed out to me that the types of communities that I was wanting to help in Louisiana were not that different from some of the First Nations communities in Canada, in that there are such very, very strong ties to the land that you can't pry the people loose. You don't want to.
And moving is not an option. Yeah.
Moving is not an option. Yeah. You want to find a way of making it possible for people to continue to live in the same place, but safely and without that kind of distress from flooding.
Mm-hmm. What is the National Research Council project you're working on?
So, 2 years ago, I was awarded a grant from the NRC to develop amphibious construction in Canada, to start developing amphibious construction in Canada as a climate change adaptation strategy for First Nations communities. Mm-hmm. So that's what we're trying to do.
Do you think that this idea is now more people are, I guess, more receptive to understanding it more than when you first suggested it?
Oh, absolutely. When I started, I couldn't mention it without being laughed at. Mm. It was rough. Oh. I got ridiculed a lot, but nobody laughs at me anymore. Everybody realizes that there are not enough good solutions out there, and this is not, it's absolutely not a one-size-fits-all solution. But for the types of situations where it can help, it can be hugely helpful, and it works much, much better than any of the other options.
In the opening, I mentioned that we need to learn to live with water. How do we as a society need to learn to live with water?
Well, that's one of my favorite themes. Mm. So I like to describe what the amphibious, a retrofitted amphibious house does as sitting lightly on the land and then lifting with the water. So the water is actually no longer the enemy, but the water is the friend that's lifting the house to safety. Mm. And it works in synchrony with the water. It lets the water flow where it wants to. It doesn't try to control the water or make it go here or make it go there. It lets the water go where the water wants to, where I believe, and this is my belief system, but I believe the water ought to be allowed to go, and that we are making a mistake as a human culture to try to put the water behind walls and into channels and levees and seawalls and all of that, because eventually there's going to be a problem. We become complacent. And I believe that if we pick a fight with Mother Nature, we're going to lose.
So we have to learn how to live and work around it.
We have to respect Mother Nature. We have to respect the power of the water. And we should do, to the extent, absolutely as much as possible, we should try to do the accommodating. There are places where the levees and the walls are already in place, and removing them would be very, very difficult, but we don't need to amplify that system.
We have about 30 seconds left, but I wanted to go back to this idea of amphibious construction taking a hold and why we should be paying attention to it. Why do you think the messaging is starting to take a hold now?
Because people realize that the other options are insufficient. We don't have enough tools in the toolkit, and this is another tool. And right now, I recommend using it for what we call pier and beam construction, which is something with a crawl space. But eventually, we'll develop this so that we can use it for basements, and we can use it for slab-on-grade construction. The other types of construction will come along. But right now, the easiest and the cheapest is the system that has a crawl space. And for me, that's also the people who are in the greatest need.
Well, Elizabeth, I wish we could talk about this more, but thank you so much for coming onto the show and educating us on this. It's so fascinating. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
The Agenda with Steve Bacon is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario. Helping businesses stay on the right side of change with strategic thinking, insightful decisions, and business leadership. Are you on the right side of change? Ask an Ontario CPA.